to equip and empower God's people, and to lead them to eternal salvation in Christ Jesus. We are the holistic ministry for our community. As Christ loves all people, our purpose is to reach out in love to everyone. Our goal is to make an impact locally, nationally, and globally with a multi-ethnic, multicultural ministry with the focal point being Jesus Christ. As Christ ministers to the total person, we strive to become an oasis of hope, addressing spiritual, emotional, and physical needs in tangible ways. Our model for excellence in all things is Christ. We commit ourselves to the spirit of excellence. We seek the highest, the finest, and the best that God has for us. We strive to honor Him and serve one another in the same spirit of excellence. Our commitment is to Christ, and our foundation is the Word of God in its entirety. We believe we can do what the Word says we can do, be who it says we can be, and have what it said.
Let us stand by doxology. Somebody give God a praise in the house. If you love the Lord, come on, let's clap our hands and give God a praise. For this is the day that the Lord has made. I shall rejoice and be glad in it. For I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Is anybody excited this morning? Come on now. Don't hold back on God's praise. Come on now, give God a praise. Hallelujah. Touch your neighbor, say praise Him. Hallelujah! Hallelujah, Jesus. Let us go through the throne of grace. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord God, as we come to you this morning, Lord God. Father, Lord God, we want to thank you, Lord God, for how you blessed us, Lord God, this morning. Father, Lord God, you gave us health, life, and strength, Lord God. Father, Lord God, you looked upon us and said you would give your son and daughter another day, Lord God, to stand, Lord, and before you, Father. So, Father, we enter this house of praise right now, Lord God, with a praise, Lord God, within our spirit, Lord God, to worship you in spirit and truth, Father. Father, Lord God, we have concerns, Lord God, but Father, we're going to pray today, Lord God. Lord God, over, Lord God, South Florida, any other countries, Lord God, as the storm raises through the sea, Father. But Father, we know that you are a covering, Lord God. So we look towards the hills, which cometh our help, Lord God. in the name of Jesus. So, Father, Lord God, bless, Lord God, our pastor, Lord God, with the word today, Lord God. Let it fall on good grounds, Lord God, and encourage someone, Lord God, that need Christ in their life, Father. And we thank you right now. This we ask in Jesus' name. Let the church say amen. Come on, give God a praise.
Come on, clap your hands in this sanctuary this morning. Let's give God the best praise that we can. Happy Sunday to you and to those who are watching us across the ABC network. Good morning to you and thank you for joining us. And to those of you who are live here in the dwelling place in Miami Gardens, can you just lift your hands, give the Lord a wave offering this morning? Hallelujah. Our Savior is beautiful. Our Savior is wonderful. We serve a mighty God. We serve an awesome wonder. Hallelujah. I saw the Lord seated on his throne, the train of his robe filled this temple, and day and night the angels proclaim, yes, come on y'all, and they cry, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is and is to come. Be exalted,
isn't he beautiful? Come on, let's sing it together. Isn't he beautiful? like fire. He's got hair like wool. He got feet like grass. Say, isn't he beautiful? Come on. Say, isn't he beautiful? Say, isn't he beautiful? Say, isn't he beautiful? Say, isn't he beautiful? Hey, say, isn't he beautiful?
God, who was our Father, and we worship the beauty in His Son, Jesus Christ. But today in this church, in this sanctuary, in this dwelling place, our prayer and our heart's desire should be that the Spirit of God, the weight of His glory, would rest on each and every one of us. Let Your glory fill this place. Let Your all-consuming fire fill this tabernacle and purify our hearts. Whoa. Surround us in this place. Breathe new life within us. Send a refreshing glory and saturate our hearts. Let Your glory fill this place.
let your glory fill this place.
All-consuming fire.
Let your all-consuming fire fill this tabernacle. And breathe new life.
Send a refreshing oil.
Send a refresh.
Saturate our hearts.
Saturate
church,
our
church.
Hearts.
This is all we're really trying to say. Rain on us.
Rain on us.
Breathe.
Breathe on.
You know what to say. Shower down.
Shower down.
Shower down.
Shower down.
Send your spirit. How many want to see the power of the Holy Ghost in the dwelling place? Say, rain on us. Breathe on your people. Everybody say, shower down.
Shower down.
Shower down.
Shower down.
Send your spirit, Lord.
Send your spirit, Lord.
Let your glory fill this place.
Let your glory fill this place.
Oh God,
surround us. Oh,
we want to feel it. Breathe new life within
and
us.
Breathe new life.
Send a refreshing glory.
Saturate
our hearts.
Saturate.
Come on, church. Let's join together and ask the Holy Spirit to rain on.
Rain on us.
Ask Him now. Breathe on your people, God.
Breathe on us.
We want to feel your shower down.
Shower.
Shower down.
Shower down.
Send your spirit, Lord.
Send your spirit,
if you want to feel the power
Lord.
Of the Holy Ghost, sing it. Rain on us.
Rain, Lord.
We know that you can breathe on us. Yeah.
Breathe,
lift it up now. Say, shower down.
Shower down.
Shower down.
Shower down.
Send your spirit, Lord.
Send your spirit, Lord.
Rain.
Rain.
Shower down,
shower down,
shower down. Come on, church. Let it rain. Turn the volume up just a little more. Let it rain. Every hand is lifted. Every voice is singing. Open the floodgates of heaven.
Open the floodgates of heaven. Let it rain.
Let it rain. We want to feel your power, Lord.
Let it rain.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let it rain. Hallelujah. 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 Let it rain. Hallelujah. Open the floodgates of heaven and let it rain. At this time, we have set aside this important time to acknowledge and welcome our visitors. If you're visiting here this morning in the dwelling place with Antioch, will you please stand? All visitors. Amen, Antioch. Let's show some love to our visitors this morning. And online, if you're visiting, check 51555. On behalf of our pastor, Arthur Jackson III, and the entire Antioch family, we welcome you here this morning to the dwelling place. We welcome you here today. We are so grateful that you're here, and we pray already that you have been inspired through our worship service and will be more uplifted through the word of God. And perhaps you may be here this morning and you want to join in with the family. At the appropriate time, you can come down and give God your heart and give a pastor or minister your hand. Again, Antioch, let's thank our visitors for coming this morning. And now, if you're a first-time visitor, will you stand? Will you remain standing? First-time visitors, if it's your first time here, will you? Amen, Antioch. Let's show some love to our first-time visitors. We're grateful that you're here this morning, and our ushers are coming down to give you a welcome package for you to fill out the card on the inside. Again, we are grateful for everyone that's here. Also, I would like to share with you that we have love offering envelopes available for our pastor, for us to be a tangible blessing to him this morning. Let's show our visitors some love, Antioch, some more love this morning. And now I call your attention to the ANN, Antioch News Network.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Antioch News Network. I'm your host, Tanya Culpepper, and I'm so delighted that you are worshiping with us here at The Dwelling Place. To our online viewership across all our ABC platforms, we truly appreciate you choosing to worship with us virtually. Today, we celebrate Hispanic Heritage Month with our brothers and sisters of Hispanic origin. So join us immediately following the 10 a.m. service in the Northwest parking lot for food, fun, and fellowship. Today is also the deadline to drop off items for our youth ministry back to school toiletry drive. So if you still have items in your car, don't forget to drop them off at the Gen X complex immediately after service. And please remember, there will be a parent meeting today with Pastor Jackson, youth leaders, and you, parents, right here in the dwelling place immediately following the 10 a.m. service. There will be no Bible study this Wednesday, September the 28th, but Pastor Arthur Jackson III will still be walking through the Word, and we're heading to Mount Bethel Baptist Church to support him as he does so. The address is 901 Northwest 11th Ave, Fort Lauderdale, Florida, 33311. See you there this coming Wednesday at 7:30 p.m. Now, Fall Revival 2022 is just about 2 weeks away with guest preacher Dr. Maurice Watson. Let's take a look.
You do know that Gethsemane was not Jesus's ultimate destination. No, Calvary was his destination. Are you with me here? So Gethsemane was just a prelude to Calvary. God understood that if Jesus wasn't strong enough to face the pressures of Gethsemane, he wouldn't be strong enough to face the pressures of the cross. Oh, I've come to tell you, friend, that if you're going through Gethsemane, if you're being crushed under the heavy weight and circumstances of life, you've got to learn to look at it another way, that God must be getting you ready for something greater. If God's allowing you to face all this hell right now, he's getting you ready for something greater.
I definitely won't miss it. You won't want to miss it either. Three powerful packed services, 7 p.m. nightly. So mark your calendars from October the 5th through the 7th for Fall Revival 2022. right here in the dwelling place. Well, that's it for this week's edition of A&N. Don't forget to check out our app to stay updated with everything happening around Antioch. And visitors, don't forget to text the word VISITOR to 51555 so we can stay connected. I'm Tanya Culpepper signing off. And remember, we're still building back better. Enjoy the rest of service.
Amen. Please stand with me and receive our pastor, Arthur Jackson III.
Well, God bless your family. Are you blessed today? Come on, if you are, turn to three people and tell them, neighbor, I'm so blessed. Come on, turn to three people and tell them, neighbor, I'm so blessed. And if you're blessed, put those blessed hands together and help me give our great God a great hand clap of praise. Come on, y'all. We could do better than that. My man. God bless you. You may be seated. In the very presence of the Lord, well, this is the day that the Lord has made. I've come to rejoice and be glad in it. Certainly, I thank God today for all of you who are worshiping with us in person. Of course, there's so many of you around the country who are logged on this morning worshiping with us. And I thank God for you persons in Tallahassee and California and Atlanta. I had a chance to speak to some of you. Thank you so much for worshiping with us and our first-time visitors who are worshiping with us today. Come on, let's give God praise again for them. It is my prayer that something has or will be said or done to make you want to come back and visit with us. And if you ever get tired of visiting, you're more than welcome to stop visiting, join, and be a part of us. We would absolutely love to have you a part of our family. Listen, we have some guests with us very, very quickly. I just kind of wanted to just give acknowledgement to them, the leadership. First, the leadership of our great city, the city of Miami Gardens. We have some of our leaders, Councilman Robert Stevens here, Councilman Woman Lillian Linda Julian. Come on, let's show, stand up, Robert. Come on, show some love. Amen. These are leaders in our city, and I'm so honored to have them with us, worshiping with us. Of course, Pastor Stevens is no stranger. He's here, pops in periodically, so glad to always have you with us. And then we have the current mayor of North Miami with us, Philip Bienemy. Please stand up, Mayor. Come on, y'all, let's show some love. Listen, he's also running. He's running. No, why are you still standing? Why are you? Come on, matter of fact, come on up here, Doc. Amen. Come on up. Come on up. Come on. Listen, one more time. Let's welcome, amen, our mayor of our great city. Come on, address us. If we're here with this lovely family, amen. He's a candidate for county commission. Amen. District number 2. Amen. Please speak to us. Address us today.
Praise the Lord, church. It's a pleasure for me to be here, worship with you. There is no better place to be than in the presence of the Lord. I'm happy to be here this morning, and I want to thank church for having a great, great leader, well known in our community. Bypass all the communities in the state of Florida and throughout the United States of America. And thank you for everything you've been doing for the community, not just for the church, for Miami Gardens, and for the black community at all. Thank you very much. And you know, I didn't have a chance to be raised by a mother because I lost mine when I was 7. And I just happened to see her for about an hour. That means when you have a mother, when you've been able to enjoy your mother, it's a blessing. That's why this morning, I want to thank Mother Jackson. Thank you very much for raising a son that's today and make you proud, a great leader in our community. My name is Philip Bienemy. I'm the mayor of the beautiful city of North Miami. For over 10 years, thank you very much, North Miami. We have been working for the past 10 years, moving the city forward. And today, the city of North Miami is on the map. We increased property value by 15%. We reduced crime by 23%. And right now, the city of North Miami is home of the biggest real estate development in Miami-Dade County. That's the city of North Miami. But for the past 10 years, one thing I've been doing is a black city. Make sure the city of North Miami remains black. While we are bringing development to the city, while we are moving the city forward, we need to make sure, like the city of Miami Gardens, the city of North Miami remain a black city. Now moving forward, I'm running for Miami-Dade County District 2. They consider the district as one of the poorest districts in Miami-Dade County. We cannot keep calling the city or the or our city and the district as the poorest district. We need economic opportunity. We need to address public safety. We need to create job and bring opportunity to the residents of District 2. That's why I'm running. The same thing that I have been doing in the beautiful city of North Miami for about 10 years, I want to continue to do so in District 2 in Miami-Dade County. And I need your support. And that's why I'm here this morning. I want your prayer and I want your support. I have with me my wife, who's been with me for 30 years, Sarah, please. And thank you very much. And I have the support of Principal Wallace Aristide. He didn't make it, but he decided to work together with me so we can continue moving the district forward. His vision, my vision. Thank you very much, and have a great day. Reverend Jackson, thank you very much.
Come on, one more time. Let's show some love. Thank you so much, Mr. Mayor, for being with us. Listen, we're moving forward in our services. One of the things that we love to do here at Antioch is we love to celebrate the diversity of our congregation. And the Lord has blessed us with a multi-ethnic, multicultural congregation. And today we celebrate Hispanic Heritage Month. Come on, let's put our hands together. Can all of our members and visitors and friends of Hispanic descent, would you please stand so we can just love on you? Come on, all those of Hispanic descent, come on, please stand. Hispanic descent, come on, y'all, stand. Come on, put those hands together. Remain standing. Come on, remain standing. Clap, 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 clap. Listen, we're so... I see you. Remain standing. Listen, we're so excited to have you worshiping with us immediately after service today. We have some food trucks. We're going to have some salsa music playing and merengue and what's that other? I didn't say reggae. Tell me what is it? Salsa. What's the other? Flamingo. Y'all don't even know. Unbelievable. Thank you. Sit down. We're going to have it. Listen, but we're so excited. And I love celebrating the diversity of our church. And so I want you to know that you're welcome. And we want to go out and we want to enjoy some of the food of your heritage, food of your culture. Amen. And so we're looking forward to doing that immediately after this service. All parents of our young people, there will be a very brief parent meeting here in the sanctuary immediately following this meeting, this service. And after that, we're going to the food truck. And we're going to hang out and do some salsa and just hang out, amen, as we enjoy. Julian, you're going to teach me and you're going to show me some moves. Julian, can you salsa? Can you? All right, don't play. Amen. Please keep our family in prayer. Many of our members are going through difficult trials and difficult circumstances, and we're praying for our church. We're praying that God will bless you and strengthen you and keep you. Listen, in all seriousness, nothing moves the hand of God faster than a child of his on their knees talking to him in prayer. So, King, we're praying. We're praying. I'm praying. We're praying praying for members of our church. On the screen are names, and I would that you would find a name. Alex, find a name on the screen. You don't have to know their need, but please call that name out in prayer. The altar is open. If you desire prayer, you want to come around the altar in prayer, you can stand now and come around the altar as we talk to God in prayer. Come on, y'all. We're praying together. We're praying together. Lord, do it. That's it.
Lord, do it for me.
Lord, do it for me.
This is our prayer today. Dante, my man, Lord, please do it. Do it for me.
Do it for me.
Right now.
Right now.
Come on, turn the volume up on your praise.
We're down here at the
Lord, do it.
Asking you to do it.
Lord, do it.
Crying out to you. We know that you have.
Good to see you, my friend. Blessings on you, man. Thank you for coming. Lord, do it, Lord.
Lord, do it.
Do it, Lord. For me right now.
Do it for me.
Right now.
Right now.
Heavenly Father, most precious and almighty God, yeah, it is here again that we gather before your throne of grace, both physically and virtually. And Father, as the names scroll across the screens, we bring our petitions to the altar and present them to you. God, some of us are going through illnesses in our family. Some of us are having difficulties with finances. Some of us are having difficulties in strained relationships, but we bring them all to you, Lord God, and lay them at your feet. Some of us, oh God, are still mourning in bereavement from the loss of our loved ones, but we know that you are a keeper. So we ask now, God, as we come before your throne, to grant us your grace, for your grace is sufficient for anything and everything that we face. And so, God, we lift up our leaders unto you this morning, God, and we pray that you would guide them up on every leading side, God, in the name of Jesus. Those of Hispanic heritage, God, we lift them up to you this morning, God, in the name of Jesus. And God, are those of the family here at Antioch, every petition, every concern, every worry, God, we bring it to you this morning and we lay it at your feet, God, knowing that you are a God that can do exceeding abundantly above all that we could ask or think, God. We say, do it for us, God, and do it for us now, God, in the name of Jesus, God. God, we lift up our pastor as he presents his word, your word, unto us, God, today. We pray that you would allow him to pour out everything that you poured into him and replenish him, God, that he may run on to see what the end's going to be. God, for every one of us that's standing before this altar today, we want to give you the glory. We want to give you the honor. We want to give you all the praise for us in the marvelous, majestic, and miracle-working name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the risen Christ. We do pray, we do thank, and we praise you. And the family of God said, amen. amen, and amen.
We're counting on you to do it, yeah.
Please do it for me, Lord.
Do it for me.
Right now.
Right now.
Oh, Lord, oh, Lord, oh, Lord, please.
You may be seated.
Please, Lord.
Do it.
You may be seated. Please, Lord. Hallelujah. Do it for me.
Do it for me.
Right now.
Right now.
We pause in the middle of our service, and our young people are getting ready to go next door to their own facility, our Gen Next complex. And so right now, can all of our young people please stand? I love this part of the service. Our young people are standing. Come on, let's give them some encouragement. Zell, you good today? All right. Pay attention. All right. Amen. Come on. Our kids are going next door. Our kids are going next door to our Gen Next complex. Our kids are going next door. Hey. Oh, you're so pretty. Hey, baby. Hey, I love your purse. That's so cute. That's nice. Yeah. Hey, bro. Okay. All right. Hand in the pocket. Hey. All right. The kids going next door. Hey. Smiles. There you go. Oh, hey, how you doing? You're so pretty. Oh, I love the bows. They're so pretty. That's nice. Yeah, okay. Yeah. All right. Oh, okay. I see you, bro. One more time. Let's celebrate our kids. They're still coming. They're going next door. Amen. Listen, we're getting ready to worship the Lord. In our time of giving. I want to thank you, Antioch, for being so faithful. During this, our time of giving, I think God has blessed me, the pastor, such a liberal church, a giving church. You know, I asked you to support the residents in Mississippi, and we were able to have enough water to send 3 tractor trailers. Come on, somebody. 3 tractor trailers all the way up to Mississippi. And so I'm so thankful to you for your contributions, and so thankful for you for just responding to the need. And of course, I would like to think that if or when hurricanes and adverse circumstances come our way, that we have so much seed in the ground, that we've been such a blessing to others, that we know it's coming back to us. Somebody say amen. That's the promise that's on the lives of a giver. The Bible says when we give, it'll be given back to us. And so I don't want you to ever get tired of giving. Don't be stingy. Don't try to hold on to your gifts. Amen. You can hold on to it and nothing will get out of your hand. But at the same time, nothing is being put back in your hand. Amen. Tap your neighbor and say, I'm a giver. And the Lord loves a cheerful giver. And so someone ought to have the testimony that the Lord showed enough love you. Because you believe in giving, you believe in sowing. Our ushers are coming forward and they have envelopes in their hands now. I would that you'd be faithful. If you're not a part of our ministry, we don't ask you to take tithes from your church to give here. But I would, though, you would sow a liberal seed, that you will sow a seed. If you're giving electronically, come on, there are several secure ways that you can give on the screen being displayed. Amen. I acknowledge some of our political guests that's with us today. I did not just acknowledge a dear friend and brother beloved. I used to pastor in South Florida. He and his lovely wife were relocated on ministerial assignment, and he's worshiping with us today. Pastor Kelly, come on, we'll just stand, man. Just wave at us. And your lovely wife, come on, y'all just wave your hand. Come on, that's my dear friend, Pastor Paul Kelly. God bless you, man. Thank you so much, amen, for not just hanging out on the beach and coming to church.
Amen, 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 amen. Listen, now, are you ready to give? If you are, can you get your envelopes in your right hand? Please stand with us. Get your phone, envelopes in your right hand. Get your envelopes together. Come on, let's wave it before the Lord one time. Amen. Wave it before the Lord. The Bible says they did not come before the Lord empty-handed. We believe that life and death lieth in the power of the tongue. Words, Brother Wallace, words are powerful. The Bible says they life and death lieth in the power of the tongue. There's a giving affirmation that we like to recite. It's on the screen. Those watching at home, you can read the screens. But together out loud, it says, Lord, I know that I can give you an offering only after I've given you the tithe. My giving reflects my total dependency on you and my obedience to your word. Though this seed leaves my hand, I believe by faith it will never leave my life. I will trust you, O God, by honoring you in my living and my giving. By faith, I now stand in obedience to have blessings released, burdens removed, and benefits restored in my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, let's everyone, let's walk around. Even if you're giving electronically, come on, get your steps in. Come on. Come on, y'all rock with it. Come on, let's come around together. Be not dismayed.
Be not dismayed.
Come on, brothers, yeah.
Whatever.
Can we tell you why?
God will.
Yes, he will.
Take
Coach, my
care
man.
Of you.
That's it. My
in
man. Beneath his wings of love abide. That's it.
Beneath his wings of love abide.
Yeah, God will.
God will.
Yes, he will.
Take
I see you. Come on, those at home, let's give. That's it. I know that God will.
I know God will.
Yeah.
Take care.
Oh, I see him, I see him.
Of you.
Through it.
Through every day.
Come what may.
Come what may.
He'll see you through.
He'll see you through.
Come on, say it like you mean it. God will. Sister Ivani, take care of you.
Take care of you.
I wish y'all helped me. Come on in the balcony. God will.
God will.
Take care.
Take care of you.
King, God bless you. God will.
God will. Take care of you.
I wish y'all said it like you mean it. God will.
God will.
God will. Yeah, 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 yeah. God will.
God will.
I wish y'all would help me. If you know God is going to take care of you, why don't you pop on your feet and open your mouth and tell someone that. Tell me God will.
Yes, sir.
Take care of you.
Take care of you.
God will.
God will. See you.
If you trust him, he will.
God will.
Hey.
Take care of you.
God will.
God will. Take
if you
care
lean on
care
him,
of
he
you.
Will.
Take care of you.
God will.
God will. See you through.
to somebody and say, I know he will. Are you ready for a preached word in this house today? Get your Bibles in your hand. Pastor, I've been trying to say this to you all day, but man, you look good today. Doesn't our pastor look fantastic today? Man, I believe that the power of the Holy Spirit is going to endow him with preaching power. But Pastor, I also believe that there may be some power in that blue suit, man. You look excellent today. God bless you. Get your Bibles in your hand. Get ready to hear a word from on high. Our hearts are open. Our ears are open to receive what the Lord has to say to us today. There is a name.
There is a name. That's a place I can run and be saved. There is a name that can play. Calm my soul.
I can call
on that name
and be saved.
Things will change.
Stand and proclaim. There's no greater name than the name Jesus. Who knows that name?
There is no greater name than the name Jesus.
Call him
Jesus.
I want to encourage somebody.
That name heals all. That name delivers all.
I want to tell you this.
It works. Really works.
Come on.
That name heals all.
That name heals
anybody
all.
Anybody know what we're talking about?
That name delivers all.
It works.
It really works.
I know it works.
It works.
Stay right there.
That name heals all.
That name heals all.
Anybody know
that name delivers all?
Tell somebody next to you. Encourage somebody around you.
That name heals all. In harmony.
That name heals all.
That name delivers
all. That name delivers
all. I wonder, do you know that it works?
It works.
Come on, stand and proclaim.
No greater name.
Sing it with us, church. Then Jesus. Anybody know about that name?
Jesus.
Come on, stand and proclaim. There is no greater name.
I want to tell you,
it's the name Jesus.
Jesus.
Stand up and proclaim. Whatever you're going through,
there's no greater name
than the name Jesus.
Jesus.
Come on, that name heals all. Come on, church.
That name heals all.
Every voice sing.
That name delivers.
Wave your hand if you're a witness that it works.
It works.
Anybody tried it?
It works.
Anybody know it?
It works.
Renee, I know that you know that name heals all.
There's another witness in the house.
That name delivers all.
That name works.
It works.
It really works.
It works.
It really works.
It works.
Hey, sing it in harmony, y'all.
That name heals all.
I know what I'm talking about.
That name delivers.
Miss Tracy,
all.
If you're watching, I know that you know it works. We're praying for Doug. Everybody, do you know that name heals all?
That name heals all.
That name delivers
that
all.
Name delivers
yeah.
all.
Yeah.
It works.
Can you stand with me as we pray? Shout it works. Hallelujah. If you've ever had to call it and it worked out for you, turn to someone's neighbor. It works. That's it. Tell them it. Come on, shout it works. Come on, it works. Come on, shout, it works.
It works. The name heals all. The name delivers all. It works. It works. It works.
We love you. We thank you for giving us access to a name that works. Thank you for giving us access to a name that delivers, a name that saves, a name that sets free. Have your way. Pray that you hide me, your servant, behind the cross, so much so that your people would see and hear none of me, but all of thee. Get glory in this house, I ask in Jesus' name. And the church said amen. As you're still standing, the time is far spent. Allow me to get right into the word of God this morning. 2 Corinthians chapter number 1. 2 Corinthians chapter 1. I want to read just two verses for you. In your leisure, go back and read the first 22 verses for a fuller understanding of this text. And as you're finding 2 Corinthians chapter 2 verse 1, let me thank God for our pastors and elders in the pulpit and those in the pew, officers of our church. I give God praise for all of our elected officials. Thank you so much for being with us today, Pastor Kelly. To those of you who are watching online, ushers, media, nurses, all of you in your respective places. I'm reading from the New International Translation of the Bible, two verses, verse 21 and 22 of 2 Corinthians chapter 1. And I encourage you today to jot down several things that I believe will be helpful in your life. Paul, writing to the church at Corinth, he said, "Now it is God who makes both us and you stand firm in Christ. He anointed us, set his seal of ownership on us, and put in his spirit
put his spirit in our hearts as a deposit guaranteeing what is to come. Again, Paul said it's God who makes us stand firm in Christ. And how he makes us stand firm in Christ is because he anointed us. He set his seal of ownership on us and then turned around and put his spirit in us as a deposit. And I felt that already. Guaranteeing what's on the way. Can you turn and you look somebody in the face and say, neighbor, it's been guaranteed. You didn't say it like it was. I mean, you got to say it like you know what's coming. Say, neighbor, I've been praying for some stuff. And the good news is, it's been guaranteed. You may be seated in the very presence of the Lord. Ushers included. This morning, my brothers and sisters, our sermonic spotlight, it shines on this second correspondence of the Apostle Paul to the church at Corinth. In your leisure, if you were to put 1 and 2 Corinthians in proximity with each other and compare the two letters, you would discover that this second letter, it differs dramatically than the first letter, primarily because in this second letter, the Apostle Paul, he's addressing the personal and spiritual attacks that he'd received by some Judaizers that had crept into the church at Corinth. These attacks, I believe, didn't catch the Apostle Paul by surprise, because the one thing all of the apostles were cognizant of, and that is, whenever you're working for Christ, attacks are going to come. Somebody better hear me well when I say that. That whenever you're doing the work of Christ, it's just a matter of time before attacks come. You could be minding your own business. You could be dotting every spiritual I and crossing every spiritual T. But if you are engaged in the work of Christ, it's just a matter of time before attacks are launched against you. In fact, that's what the Apostle Peter alluded to in 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse 12. He said, and I quote, "Beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial which shall try some of you, as if some strange thing has happened." In other words, Peter is suggesting that if we are doing the work of Christ, at some point in your sojourn, you're going to have some kind of confrontation with the devil. My daddy, who went home to be with the Lord 20 years ago, he put it like this. He said that if you are going in the opposite of direction of the devil, at some point, y'all ought to collide. He said that he's scared of folk that never have trouble. Scared of folk that never run into adversity. And he says, because if you never run into the devil, chances are y'all going the same way. In this letter, Paul addresses these attacks, and he does so in the first 22 verses by mentioning three things. He opens chapter 1, number 1, by talking about the grief he experienced. Secondly, he talks about the grace that was extended. And then thirdly, he talks about the guarantee that he was expecting. In verse 8 and 9, Paul, if you're taking notes, he opens this chapter talking about the grief that he experienced. He says, "I want you not to be uninformed, brothers and sisters," that's verse 8, "about the trouble that we had in Asia." And he begins to describe, Todd, the trouble that he had in Asia. I'm in verse 8. If your Bibles are open,
Paul says, I want you to know, King James Version, he says, brethren, I don't want you to be ignorant concerning the trials that we've had in Asia. He describes those trials in verse 8 as being a great pressure far beyond his own ability to endure. He goes on to say in verse number 9 that those trials he experienced in Asia, Angie, he likened them to the sentence of death being placed on him. Paul is making the point that the calling on our lives does not stop calamity in our lives. Paul is writing to the church, and he's telling the church, King, I want you all to know that just because I'm Paul, just because I'm the one who's credited for writing the better part of the New Testament, just because I sat at the feet of Gamaliel, just because I'm God's ambassador, I am the leader of the Apostolic 12, that doesn't exempt me from having trouble. He says, I want you to know I've experienced some grief. He wanted the church to know I've been through some stuff, and I'm talking to somebody right now that can co-sign that statement. You can live vicariously through Paul's testimony that this has been a difficult year for somebody I'm talking to. Somebody under the sound of my voice, you ain't got to raise your hand. It's a testimony of your survival. The mere fact you're able to walk in the building this morning and still maintain your praise, you've gone through some trial. But amid talking about the grief he experienced in verse 10, he talks about the grace that was extended to him. Please don't miss that. Verse 8 and 9, Paul talks about the grief that he experienced, but he backs that up by suggesting that in the midst of receiving grief, I was the recipient of grace. Somebody should put a praise right there, because you know that in the midst of your grief you've experienced, God has extended his grace. I want you to know before I go any further that what the text is telling to teach us is that whenever we experience our grief, God always extends his grace. And if you're honest, you have to admit that his grace is always greater than our grief. In fact, it was this same Paul writing in this same narrative, Dante, who said later in chapter 12 that he was given a thorn in the flesh. It was the messenger of Satan. And Paul talked about going to the Lord on three different occasions, Sister Pringle, asking the Lord to remove this thorn from his side. And all three times God says no, but my grace is sufficient for you. Paul had the revelation that while God will not remove our grief, he will release his grace. And the shout this morning is, his grace is always greater than our grief. Paul talked about the grief he experienced in verse number 8 and 9, but this grace that was extended to him in verse number 10, it came in the form of deliverance. In fact, in verse number 10, Paul says three things about God's deliverance. Please note the text. In verse number 10, Paul said, God delivered. Then he said, God will deliver. And then he says, God continues to deliver. In fact, if you can put verse 10 on the screen, let's read it together. Paul said, he has delivered us from such a deadly peril. He will deliver again, and on him we've set our hope that he will continue to deliver. Are y'all with me today? Come on, let's read it out loud together. Paul says he has delivered us, come on church, from such a deadly peril, and he will deliver us again, and on him we have set our hopes that he will yet continue to deliver. Please note how powerful verse 10 is, because verse 10 talks about the trichotomy of God's deliverance. Verse 10 talks about the three different ways God has and will deliver. It talks about how God has delivered in the past, how God will deliver in the future. Come on, talk to me. And how God, I got the wrong crowd, how God is delivering right now. Somebody ought to open up your mouth behind your mask and
Praise God, because you can relate to all three. And in fact, somebody right now, you're here this morning because God has delivered. It, oh, come on, fess up. You haven't always been holy. You hadn't always done the right thing. You hadn't always been at the right place at the right time doing the right thing. In fact, we've been wrong more times than we've been right. But our testimony is in the past, God has been a deliverer. I wish I can stand here this morning and tell you how many times I've been in the snare of the fowler. And it was the Lord that came and brought me out and then broke the snare. Come on, talk. I wish I can testify about the countless times, Sister Dickerson, when the Lord had me in a precarious predicament. Mama couldn't help me. Daddy couldn't help me. Friends couldn't help me. But if it had not been for the Lord that stepped in my context, and I'm a living, moving witness that God has been a deliverer. I got the wrong crowd. Can somebody fist bump your neighbor's neighbor? He's talking about me now. When you look at where he's brought me from, I'm not where I ought to be, but thank God I'm not where I used to be, because God has been. Tell somebody he's been a deliverer. When I look, Paul, in the rear view mirror of my life, my testimony is he's been a deliverer. But Paul says that God just didn't deliver in the past. He says, put it on the screen, verse 10. He says, yet he will. I got the wrong crowd. The fact that God has delivered, that's my proof. But the fact that he will deliver, that's my promise. Tells me I got a promise in my pocket. I got a promise. The promise is the same God that did it then will do it again in the future. The promise is that the same God that delivered me in the yesterdays of my life will deliver me in the tomorrows of my life. My promise is the same God back then will be the same God right now. My promise is I know what God is going to do because I remember what God has already done. The fact that he's dried my tears in the past, it lets me know when I cry the next time, weeping would endure for a night, but joy, I got the wrong crowd, it is coming in the morning, because he's healed me before. Nettie J. Smooth, my praise is when I get sick in the future, the same God that healed me yesterday, I got the wrong. Is there anybody in Antioch this morning that can praise God for a promise? Come on, that can praise God, because God is not the man that shall lie or the son of man that has to repent, but if he said he's going to do it, he's going to do it. He's going to deliver your child. He's going to bring you out. He's going to heal your body. He's going to turn things around. He's going to dry your tears. He's going to do it. Put verse 10 on the screen. Tech says he's delivered us from such a deadly peril, and he will. God, I shout right there. He will tell three people. He will. He will. Y'all ain't talking. I said, tell somebody, neighbor, he will. He will. He will. Pastor, how do you know he will? Because he has. He has. He has. And because he has, I know that he will. People that know he has are people that should know he. I got the wrong crowd. Paul said, because he has. I feel like preaching today. He said he's delivered us from such a great deadly peril, and he will deliver. And because he's delivered in the past, which is my proof, and he will deliver in the future, which is my promise, he says he will continue. That's my present. Anybody going through something right now? Well, child of God, he's going to continue. Tell somebody, neighbor, he's going to continue. He's not going to stop doing what he has done or what he promised he's going to do. And so Paul, in writing to the church at Corinth, he opens verse 8 and 9 talking about the grief that he experienced. In verse 10, he talks about the grace that was extended. But in our narrative this morning, in verse 21 and 22, Paul then shifts and he talks about the guarantee he was expecting. Paul had great expectancy. Paul was expecting something. And what Paul was expecting was this. He was expecting that God was going to allow him to stand firm. If your Bibles are open, stay with me in verse 21 one more time. This is how the text opens. The text opens like this. Paul says, it is God who makes us and you stand firm in Christ. The guarantee that's mentioned in the text for clarity, he's guaranteeing us our ability to stand firm. I need the whole church to shout, stand firm. Paul is saying you are going to stand firm. Standing firm, for those who are taking notes, mean this. It means that you're going to hold your position. Standing firm means that you're going to be able to withstand what you're going through. Standing firm means that you're going to come through what you're going through. Stand firm means this. It means you can handle what's been handed. Oh my God, somebody need to write that down. Standing firm means you can handle what's been handed. Can you help me preach? Tell your neighbor you can handle what's been handed to you. I'm talking to somebody right now, and I don't know what the Lord has handed to you. I look around the room and somebody's been handed some disease. You've been handed some medical malady in your life. Someone else, you've been handed depression. You've been handed disappointment. I see your hands. I'm talking to somebody right now who's been handed divorce and handed danger and handed something that you feel that's beyond your ability to handle. But the devil is a liar. The Lord sent me here this morning to remind you that you can handle whatever God allows. Y'all gonna get to know your neighbor. Can you turn to him one more time and say, neighbor, if God allowed it, you can handle it. If he allowed you to get laid off, it's because God got a door open in the future that no man can close. If God allowed you to spend some time in that hospital, you're there to get a word or to give a word. If God allowed that person to walk out your life, it's because he's got somebody getting ready to walk in. Come on, help me talk. If God allowed mama to die, daddy to die, friends to die, it's because they've served their purpose in their life, in your life, and they've deposited into you already that what you need. They've laid the foundation of your faith for you to build your life upon. Y'all ain't with me today. If God allowed it, you can handle it. I know you can handle it, because if you couldn't have handled it, you would have been dead a long time ago. But the mere fact, early this morning, the Lord touched you with the finger of love and your eye. I got the wrong crowd. The mere fact you walked in the dwelling place this morning is a harbinger that you can handle. If you couldn't have handled it, you would have thrown in the towel. You would have waved the white flag. But the mere fact you got a praise in your lips, the mere fact you got joy in your heart, pat yourself on the chest and tell yourself, I can handle it. Tell yourself, I can handle this. Come on, remind yourself. Y'all ain't talking. Come on, words are powerful. Life and death lieth in the power of the tongue. Learn how to speak life. Pat yourself on the chest and remind yourself, I can handle this. I gotta cry sometime, but I can handle it. I gotta suffer sometime, but I can handle it. I'm lonely sometime, but I can handle it. I'm not living like I wanna live, not living like I wanna, where I wanna live. But when push comes to shove, you got the right one, baby. I can handle it. God, I feel like preaching today. Sit down. Let me work slow. Someone's not convinced. And you're saying, Pastor Jackson, give me some proof in the text. Give me something I can go home with. Give me something I can take home with me. Well, in the narrative, Paul gives us three reasons why we can handle it. I'll give you all three, and I'll come back and explain it very quickly. He says, you can handle it. You are guaranteed to stand firm. Three reasons why. He says, number one, you have the anointing of God with you. You have the authority of God on you. And you have the agent of God in you. Ooh, wee, God, that should have shouted somebody. Right, I'll try it one more time. I used to be slow too, so I'm very patient when people don't get it the first time. He says, you can handle it because you got something with you, you got something on you, and you got something in you. You got the anointing of God with you, you have the agent, authority of God on you, and then you have the agent of God in you. Keep your Bibles open. In verse 21, keep your Bibles open. Paul said these words. Paul says, it is God who made both us and you stand firm in Christ. He has, Angie, anointed us. Lean over, tell somebody, I'm anointed. Well, what does that mean? What does that mean when the Lord says that you are anointed? Why is that such a reason to give God praise, the fact that you are anointed? Why is it such a big deal that the Lord has anointed you? It's because I know what the anointing is. And for those of you who don't know what the anointing is, can I give you a scripture? Isaiah chapter 10, verse 27. Write it down. Isaiah 10, 27 says these words. It suggests that the anointing is the yoke destroying, burden removing power of God. Y'all don't know when to shout. The anointing is the yoke destroying, burden removing power of God. Come on, repeat it with me. Say the yoke destroying, burden removing power of God. That's what the anointing is. The anointing, Nettie, is the yoke destroying, burden removing power of God. So, Sister Hector, that means this. If the anointing is with me, it means when I show up, I got a yoke destroying, burden removing force showing up with me. It means that when I get in my classroom, I got a yoke destroying, burden removing force in the classroom with me. It means when I open my mouth, I got a yoke destroying, burden removing force speaking with me. When I grab the mic to preach, I got a yoke destroying, burden removing force preaching. Y'all ain't got it yet. When I go to court, I got a yoke destroying, burden removing force going to court with me. When I go into surgery, I got a yoke destroying, y'all ain't got it yet, burden removing force in surgery with me. When I stand before the judge, I got a yoke destroying, burden removing force standing. I got the wrong crowd. When you go to court done, you got a yoke destroying, burden removing for in court with you. I got the wrong crowd. Any teachers in the building, when you stand in front of your classroom tomorrow, you got a yoke destroying, burden removing force standing in front of those children. You have the anointing. That's why I'm able to handle what I'm handling. Because it's not my education that's destroying the yoke. It's not my resources that's destroying the yoke. It's not the degrees behind my name or the letters in front of my name that's destroying the yoke. It's not who I know and who knows me that's removing the burdens. It's not where I live that's I got the wrong crowd, that's removing the burdens. But what's destroying the yoke and removing the burdens is the fact that the Lord has anointed me. And here's the shout. He anointed me before the crash. He anointed me before the incident. He anointed me before the divorce. He anointed me before the career breakdown. In fact, I walked into the situation anointed. That's why I was able to walk in and walk up. That's why I don't look like what I've been through, because before I went through, the Lord anointed me. But wait. I just don't have an anointing with me I have an authority on me. Tell somebody I got an authority on my life. I'm in verse 22. He says, watch the text. The text says, Sherry, watch the text. He says, it is God who made both you, us and you, stand firm in Christ. He's anointed us. But then it says, watch this, Philip. He says, and he set his seal of ownership on us. Look this way. I like this word seal because when you read the Bible, let me teach this morning. When you read the Bible, you'll discover that every time you see the word seal in the Bible, the word seal is synonymous with authority. The word seal is synonymous with authority. So when you see the word seal in the Bible, every example of a seal, it comes with authority. For instance, kings would wear rings, and oftentimes there will be a design or some kind of insignia inside of the ring. And what a king would do is a king would put that ring in some hot wax or some soft clay and then make an impression on a document. And that impression on the document of the king's seal authorized the document. In fact, it made it so legitimate until when people saw the seal, it automatically caused them to stay away from it because authority is associated with the seal. Can I give you all some scriptures if you're taking notes? 1 Kings chapter 21 verse 8. Read it when you get home. The Bible suggests there was a woman named Jezebel who was married to a king named Ahab. And what Jezebel did with her slick self, she went and got the king's stationery and she signed the king's name and his seal on the document and had Naboth executed. Because when the people saw the seal, come on y'all, they automatically thought it was coming from Ahab because the seal came. Okay, you don't like that one. Esther chapter number 8, verse number 8 suggests that King Xerxes had a seal. And the Bible says in Esther chapter 8, verse number 8, that every document with the king's name and the king's seal on it could not be revoked. Are y'all hearing me? Matthew chapter 27, verse 66, Sister Collins, the Bible says when Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to the tomb early in the morning, they were afraid because Pilate did three things. He put soldiers around the stone. He put a stone in front of the tomb, and then he put a seal on top of the tomb. That's because every time you saw a seal in the Bible, the seal spoke of authority. But here's our shout. Our shout is this, that Pilate is not the only person with a seal. Xerxes is not the only king with a seal. Y'all ain't talking to me. Our shout is, Ahab ain't the only one with a seal. Our shout is, our God has a seal, and the good news is he sealed your life. There's authority on your life. That's why the Bible says no weapon formed against you shall prosper. It's because even the devil knows that he got to back up off a child of God. I wish I had a praying church. You ought to act like you got a seal on your life, and when you know you have authority on you, you walk with authority, you talk with authority, you live with authority. Why? I got the seal of God on my life. I need you to tell somebody, say, neighbor, I'm not ordinary. No. You didn't say it like you meant it. I need you to tell somebody, neighbor, I'm not regular. No, boo, I'm not ordinary. I'm not run of the mill. You're sitting beside somebody with some authority on their life. You got to respect me when you see me because I got the seal that you can't talk to me any kind of way. You can't treat me any kind of way. You can't degrade me. You can't call me out my name. Why? I got the wrong crowd. When I walk in the room, you better recognize who's here. When I get the mic, recognize who got the mic. Why? Because I'm operating in authority. In fact, you better be careful how you talk about me. Tell me, never keep your hands off me. Keep your hands off me. In fact, you can't see it, but I got a sign over my life that says hands off. I got you. You can't see it. You can't see it. But I got a sign over my life that says, please don't touch me. Because Psalm 105 says, 15 says, touch not my anointed. Be careful how you talk about folk that got a seal on their lives. Be careful how you treat people that got a seal on their lives. Be careful how you dog folk that got a seal on your life. I may not be perfect, but I got a seal on my life. You may not dot every I. You may not cross every T. You may fall down sometime, but if your life is sealed, you have authority.
Sit down. I'm almost finished. It's guaranteed. How do I know it's been guaranteed? Well, first of all, I got something with me. I have the anointing of God with me. I have a yoke-destroying, burden-removing force that's with me. But not only do I have the anointing of God with me, I have the authority of God on me. He sealed my life. But then I have the agent of God in me. I'm in verse 21 and 22. I promise I'm almost done. He says, it is God. Y'all gonna get this text. It is God who made both us and you stand firm in Christ. He has anointed us, set his seal of ownership on us, and then put his spirit in us as a deposit. I'm getting happy already. I was making a purchase recently, and the salesperson I was speaking to, he said, listen, Mr. Jackson, I'm going to have to take a deposit from you. I said, okay, no problem. I gave him my credit card number, and I asked him, I said, how large? He says, a sizable deposit. I said, okay, no problem. I gave him a credit card number, and I was expecting him, Linda, to run the charge through, because he said he needed a deposit on the item mark I was getting ready to purchase. But I noticed a few days later when I called my credit card company, I noticed that there was no charge on the credit card. And then it dawned on me that what the salesman was doing, he was not checking, y'all ain't hearing me, my substance. He was checking my seriousness. Because the salesman, in his mind, his thought was, I don't know if you're serious about this or not, and I don't want to waste my time. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to ask this gentleman for a large deposit. And if he's willing to give me a deposit on this particular item, then I know that he's serious. I'll try it one more time. He was not interested in my substance at that point. He was only interested in my seriousness. He didn't want me to waste his time. He felt if I put a deposit down, and a sizable deposit down, that would speak of my seriousness, because the size of the deposit, it speaks of the seriousness of the purchaser. Y'all ain't hearing. You don't know when to shout. Here in the text, God wants us to know how serious he is. He says, I want to show you how serious I am about your ability to stand firm in Christ. I'm going to put down a deposit. And it ain't going to be no small deposit. I want to show you how serious I am by giving you the biggest and the best deposit I have. I'm going to wrap myself up in self, and I'm going to put my spirit inside of you as a deposit that's going to guarantee. I got the wrong. Can I try it one more time? God says, I'm so serious about your ability to take a licking and keep on ticking. I'm going to put a deposit on that.
that thing. And I'm going to wrap myself up in myself. And I'm going to give me as a deposit to you to guarantee of the things that is to come. You don't know when to shout. I'm trying to tell you that God is so serious about your ability to withstand. He's willing to put down the biggest and the best deposit to guarantee that come hell or high water, when the dust settles, you are still going to be standing. And somebody walked in the building this morning and you got some concerns because you've been trying to figure out, am I going to survive this or am I not going to survive it? But King, the Lord told me to tell you, you got a guarantee. Somebody walked in the building today worried about a child who's going astray, and in the back of your mind you're trying to figure out, is my child going to be all right? Will my child be saved? Well, child of God, dry your weeping eyes, because the Lord has given you a deposit. Somebody else walked in the building concerned about a medical crisis. Cancer may be in your body, and in the back of your mind you're trying to look at survival rates, you're trying to look at the statistics. But oh, child of God, the Lord sent me here to tell you this morning, stop looking at the statistics. I'll make you an exception. You shall live and not die. Somebody else walked in the building concerned about the direction of your life. You may be in between jobs, not knowing what's going to happen, praying to God, asking the Lord to make a way out of no way. Well, child of God, I came to tell you, you have a guarantee. Can I give it to you in scripture? And we know all things work together for the good of them who love the Lord, to those who are called according to his purpose. Turn to your neighbor and look him in the face and tell him, neighbor, if you want to know why I'm shouting now, come on, talk to him. Tell him, neighbor, if you want to know why I got my praise, if you want to know why I'm leaping and jumping and shouting and running and I don't have money in the bank, it's because I got a guarantee that God will turn things around in my life. I don't know who I'm talking to, but I wish I had 1,000 folk in the building who know you got a guarantee to pop up on your feet and tell your neighbor, neighbor, I got it. I got a guarantee that weeping may endure for a night. The joy is coming in the morning. That's the wrong one. Find another neighbor. Look him in the face and tell him, neighbor, I got a guarantee. Everything gonna be all right. If you know it's gonna be all right, walk it out. If you know it's gonna be all right, come on, walk it out. Just walk around the building. Lift your head, oh ye gates. Be lifted up, everlasting arms. And the King of glory shall come in. Who is the King of glory? The Lord, strong and mighty. The Lord, mighty in battle. Ain't he all right? Ain't he all right? Yes! 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 Tell three people, it's been guaranteed. That's the wrong somebody. I need a church. Find somebody. Neighbor, it's guaranteed. Yes. Folk with a guarantee walk different. Folk with a guarantee talk different. Folk with a guarantee live different. I wish you'd walk like you got it. I wish you would talk like you got it. I wish you shout like you got it. I wish you open up your mouth like you got it. I wish you open up your mouth and tell somebody, I got it, I got it. 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 That's why. That's why I'm able to bounce back. That's why I'm still here. That's why I look like I look. That's why I dress like I dress. That's why I preach like I preach. That's why I live like I live. That's why I am who I am. I got it. I got it. I got it! I got it! Tell me that it's been guaranteed. Guaranteed. I'm done. It's been guaranteed. I'm done. It's been guaranteed. I need somebody at the altar who's been wavering, who's been vacillating in your faith. If that's you, it ain't everybody, but if that's you, I need, very quickly, if that's you, I need to speak into your life. No weapon formed against you shall prosper. Come on, come on, come on, if that's you. Come on, if that's you, come on, if that's you. I need to speak, I need to speak. Come on, I need to speak into your life. Come quickly, come quickly. If you've been wavering, if you've been wondering, if you've been vacillating, if you've been concerned whether I'm going to win, whether I'm not going to win, whether I'm going to be healed, if I'm not going to be healed, am I going to make it? Am I not going to make it? Am I going to survive? Am I not going to survive? I got the answer for you today. And the today is, you have a guarantee. Kelsey, you got the guarantee, baby. Man, you got a guarantee. Listen, I gotta say this. I have to say this. Deborah, bring this brother to the front. Bring him to the front. I promise, I gotta go. But you gotta hear this. You gotta hear this. Sister P, what effects, and your boy was in church today, what effects our confidence, hear this, Phil, hear this, Aristide, hear this. Sometimes we start doubting because we're looking at the wrong stuff. We look at what we lost, and we don't look at what we got left. Look at what we lost. So you're saying, man, I lost the job. I lost some money. I lost some time. I lost this relationship. I may lose my reputation. I'm going to lose all this stuff. But my thing is, it's not what you lost. It's what you got left. What do you have left? Well, I got at least three things. I got an anointing with me. I have an authority on me, and I got the advocate. I got his agent. I got his spirit in me. And with what I got with me and on me and in me, baby, I'm gonna make it. I wish I had somebody with that confidence. I'm gonna pray. I got some people here who's been knowing me a long time. But I tell folk, if you ever see me depressed, look quick. If you ever see me having a rough, a bad day, look quick. Because it don't last. I've got too much left. Oh, I've lost some stuff. I've lost some stuff. I've lost some stuff. I've lost some friends and some relationships and some money. I've lost some stuff. But brother, I got so much left. I need to pray for you. I need to pray for you at this altar, because I don't want you to leave here wavering in your faith. I don't need you to leave here today wondering how this is going to work out. I'll say this, I'm trying to finish. I like teams on the West Coast. And oftentimes when I watch, trying to stay up at night, because I go to bed so early, I miss the games. So what I do is I record the games. I record the games. And don't judge me, but I only watch the game if my team won. Don't judge me. So, last basketball season, I fell asleep watching the Warrior game. I woke up the next morning, first thing I do, I check to see if they won. When they won, I watched the game. But as I'm watching the game, this game went into overtime. And I was getting nervous because the game was close. And it looked like they were gonna lose. And I hate watching my team when they lose. And I started to turn the TV off. But I reminded myself, I know how this ends. In the end, my team win. Y'all think I'm talking about basketball. I'm talking about you. In the end, check the score. Jesus died. 3 days later, he got up. Our team wins. So listen, you need to know, baby, you need to know. I see your tears, but I need to pray for you, because those need to be tears of sorrow. Brother, I saw you bent over. But listen, you need to be bent over in blessings. You need to get this. I need to pray for you, because you need to know how the story ends. You have a guarantee. Every head by God our Father, I pray for this altar. I pray for these husbands. I pray for these wives. I pray for these single men, these single women. I pray for these children. I pray for these adults. I pray for these grandmothers, these grandfathers. Heavenly Father, I pray right now for this altar. Oh, they come with a plethora of problems. And oh God, some feel as if they're not going to make it. Some are going through sickness, and some facing divorce, and some facing financial hardship. Some in between blessings. Some right now overqualified for a job and they can't find a job. But I pray, Heavenly Father, in your name, help them to realize it's been guaranteed. Help them to not wait for the biopsy to report. Help them not to wait for the scan. Help them to leave here today knowing I'm already a victor. I've already won. Help them to realize I got an anointing with them. An anointing with them. An agent in them. An authority on them. Do it for them now, God, in the name of Jesus Christ. I pray for faith. Strengthen their faith. Encourage their hearts. And then, oh God, I pray finally, connect them with a strong believer. Put a close angel in the form of an ally. Put somebody in their circle who can hold on to the faith. Bless my brothers and my sisters now. I ask this in Jesus' name. And the church shouted, amen. Listen. Somebody right now, you need, listen, don't move yet. You need to be in church. You need a pastor. Listen, what's the right church for you? The right church is not the biggest church. The right church is not the most popular pastor. The right church don't have the best music necessarily. But the right church is when you go and you feel that the word is hitting you center mass every time you go. The right church is when you go and you feel as if their mission aligns with your purpose in life. The right church is when God gives you a heart for something and you discover that that church is doing what you got a heart for. The right church is when you can go and the pastor is relatable. The right church is when you go and the people are relatable. For somebody, this is the right church for you. The doors of the church are open. If you don't have a church home, stay at the altar or come to the altar. If you're looking for a church, I want to be your pastor. And the person beside you want to be your sister, your brother in Christ. If you have a church, you can go back to your seat. If not, stay at the altar. Come on, stay at the altar. Come on, give God praise to this brother. Come to the altar. Come on, are there others? Come on. Come on, come on. Give God praise. Come on, give God praise. They're at the altar. Come on, give God praise. Are there others? Are there others? Are there others? Come on, church, put those hands together. My sister, are there others? The doors of the church are open. Come on, come on. We have not dismissed yet. Come on, we're leaving right now. 3 minutes, we're leaving right now. Come on, let's give God praise for the increase. Come on. Come on, we're not leaving yet. The benediction has not been given yet. I need to say this. We're going to pray. Extend your right hand to this altar, these two sisters. God, our Father, we love you. We cover them. We plead the blood of Christ over their life. Bless them. We pray that no weapon formed against them would prosper. Go with them and keep them now. I ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Come on. I bless you. Come on. Another sister with us today. Love you. Come on. You're going to go right to my right. Come on. Listen. Hold the doors, ushers. Hold the doors. Hold the doors, ushers. Hold the doors. Hold the doors. We're leaving. We're leaving. We're leaving. Come right there. Oh, man. Another one has come. Come on. Let's give God praise. Amen. Another one. I got to say two things. Two things. It's 11:51. We're going to be out by 11:53. Two things very quickly. As parents, how many of us are parents in the building? All parents, raise your hand. Parents, parents, parents. Listen, as parents, one of the things that we try to do as parents, we want our kids to stay in school until the bell rings, until school is dismissed. As parents, we send the wrong message if we leave before the benediction. The benediction is the bell that dismissed the service. That's the first thing. Yes, Dorothy Kendall. Yes, baby. We have some honest ushers. Somebody in what section was it? Somebody in this section over there, you dropped some money and it's in my hands. And if you can tell me how much it was and the serial numbers. In reverse order. If you can tell me the serial numbers in reverse order, this is your money. If you can't, why you, you said it was over there? So did somebody over here lose some money? They say no. Listen, I say the Lord has increased. I say the Lord has blessed. Okay. I'm just serious. Thank you. Listen, lastly, can our seniors be exit first? Seniors and disability, persons with seniors, handicaps, and disabilities, can you please be dismissed? One of the problems that we have is that we're in such a big hurry, we're running over our seniors and persons of disability. Listen, we have our Hispanic heritage. Listen, our Hispanic heritage, we have food trucks outside. Listen, y'all, I know there's a game, and we're trying to go there, right? But we got these food trucks. Amen. Hispanic heritage. So I need y'all to support the food trucks. Amen. And Caribbean heritage and Haitian heritage. We stay. So we want to support Hispanic heritage. So please, let's go to our food trucks. Amen. All seniors, please be dismissed. Seniors, you need a little extra time like we do on the plane. Need a little extra time. Amen. Need a little extra time. Amen. Go on a little extra time. Amen. We've been running over our seniors. Amen. Devil is a liar. Amen. Y'all ain't going to hinder my blessings. Amen. Seniors need extra time. Amen. A little extra time. Amen. Amen. This is let pre-boarding. We're pre-boarding now. Our seniors. A little extra time. Let's stop pre-board. Stop pre. I'll pre-board. You ain't no. You don't need no extra time. Healthy as you are. God our Father, we love you. Thank you for this service. Dismiss us from this place. Never your presence. In Jesus' name, amen. Paul Kelly, I love you, bro. Linda Julian, you're my girl. Robert, Mayor. Wallace Aristide, bless you. Dante, my man, my leader.